Training Center Church here as well. Open your Bibles tonight to the Epistle of Colossians. Epistle of Colossians. You guys that may be joining us online tonight, we're going to continue our verse-by-verse expository study through Paul the Apostle's letter to the church at Colossae, or as we call it, the Epistle of Colossians. This is our third week, so we haven't gotten real far, so if you haven't been with us, you can certainly catch up. If you want the previous week's notes and you're here in this place, you can see my daughter Beezy right there. She's got those notes and she will gladly share those with you from the previous 2 weeks. Or you can go to my Facebook page and just scroll down the previous two Wednesdays and you can watch the recorded live service as well. Folks, just kind of some information to kind of catch you guys up and bring you up to this. Tonight we're going to kind of catch the second part of the cliffhanger last week, but kind of left you hanging on because we ran out of time. But as you know, and kind of put these things in perspective and context, this is a corrective letter that was sent to a church as really a means to kind of identify several areas in which they had allowed some false doctrine to enter into this fellowship of believers. And really, it wasn't gone just strictly corrective. It was in the hopes that they would really kind of come back to just the simplicity of the gospel message. And that gospel message, you know, we talked about kind of that, that the theme of it is described right there in that second chapter of Colossians, verses 9 and 10, that in him dwelleth the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and that we're complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. Don't that sound simple? That in Jesus dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and in him we're complete. As simple as that is, isn't it so simple to get away from that? How many of you have fallen in kind of a works trap? Anybody? It's not just as simple as just believing what God did, and I do those things as a result of it, but always feeling like you're performance-based or comparison and things of that nature. Folks will fall into that trap. Amen. And so they had began really to embrace several schools of thought in the Epistle of Colossians that really kind of served to really minimalize the redemptive work of the cross. And as a result, it would nullify the grace of God upon the life of the true believer. But you don't want to not walk under the auspices of the influence of the grace of God. And so all these three things we've discussed, the asceticism, which was that just basically that practice of denying anything pleasurable, anything convenient, anything indulgent, just simply, if I do those things, if I kind of suffer and make myself suffer, then somehow God's going to have favor upon me. How many of you know that there's only one that suffered and gained favor for us? And that was Jesus. He suffered for us. The second thing was legalism, or attempting to attain righteousness through some of the adherence of some man-made rules, regulations, or rituals. And so if I do this, or if I perform to a certain degree, or I do certain things, and somehow God is going to love me more. Or in Gnosticism, but believing that some type of superior knowledge, or if I've gained some type of deeper cognitive understanding, that it's something that's going to give me the power to become righteous. And while all of those things are really somewhat different in approach, obviously, they all really have one thing in common, and it's really dependence upon the works and the actions of men regard to salvation above really the benevolence work of Jesus. And so, folks, listen, Jesus plus anything else eliminates Jesus. Okay, so Jesus plus equals zero. And so we've got to see that it's faith and faith alone, that he's the one that we come to. Galatians 2:21 kind of says it this way. Paul the Apostle, once again, writing to the church of Galatia, he said, I don't treat the grace of God as meaningless. Do you ever treat the grace of God as meaningless? Paul said, I'm not going to do that. And he said, for if keeping the law could make us right with God, then there's no need for Christ to die. In other words, when you adhere to those principles, those things that they had once again allowed to seep in the Colossian letter, and Paul addressing it to the church of Galatia, he said, you know, who has bewitched you, foolish Galatians, is what he told them. He said that you've believed another gospel. And he told them, he said, it's not even a gospel at all. There's no good news in it. Why? Because it nullifies the work of grace. Folks, anything that nullifies the work of grace in our complete and only dependence upon the cross of Calvary is not a gospel at all. It's heresy. It's false doctrine. And so this does include really a kind of a direct application when Paul was addressing the church of Galatians to the law of Moses, obviously. But interesting to me, the word that's used here for law would also include any type of religious way of thinking. So if I'm just getting religious in my thinking or any type of force or compelling action, if I allow those things to somehow be my key to righteousness, then what I've done is I've called the cross of Christ ineffectual. It doesn't work in my life. And so Paul was basically challenging any school of thought that would in any way interject something besides the grace of God as demonstrated through the redemptive work of the cross of Calvary as a means to obtain righteousness. And so we talked about that the purpose that we looked at, the purpose of this letter was what? One of correction. And so I'm going to finish up tonight on the platform that we looked at, and we're going to finish that tonight. And the platform of that was what? You remember, the apostolic office. And so what gave him a platform was his office. And so I kind of cut you off on a couple of things. We're going to get back to that. But what's interesting, you know, we started out Colossians 1:1. It says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God. By the will of God. You know, sometimes we look at that word will, and we think about it in terms of human thought and things of that nature. But that word will is a word which literally means a desire. It's we would call it a wish. Or it's often referred to God's preference. And so it says, listen, by the preference of God, or his best offer to people, which they can either accept or reject. And so Paul was saying, I'm an apostle of Jesus Christ. This is the best case scenario, and it's up to you to accept that or to reject that. And so, folks, listen, if you catch that part, though, it talks about that is the will of God. And so the will of God is always, and write this down if you're taking notes, it's always his preference to something. It's God's preference to something. Now, when God gives us a preference, we do have the choice to accept that or to reject that. And so we can either choose life or we can choose death. And we'll look at some of those verses just a minute. And so that's important, because what I think is most people don't really have an understanding what the will of God is or how the will of God is appropriated in their lives. So I'm going to prove that to you. If you have your Bibles tonight, turn all the way back to the book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 30. Y'all be good to that baby back there. See, when I hear babies cry, it's like getting an amen. So y'all leave silence alone. Deuteronomy chapter 30 tonight. I'm going to get a reading in verse 11 through 20. Some of these things that are in this text just going to be very familiar to you, maybe not within this context. But think about it. And remember, we're talking about understanding God's will for our life in conjunction with Colossians 1:1, that Paul the Apostle was an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. And so this is what the writer of Deuteronomy, Moses, penned. He said, this command, let me say command. He said, this command I'm giving you today is not too difficult for you, and it's not beyond your reach. In other words, I'm going to tell you something that's not unattainable. It's something that you can reach. It's something that you can experience. He said in verse 12, he said, it's not kept in heaven, so distant that you must ask, who will go up to heaven and bring it down so we can hear it and obey? It's not kept beyond the sea, so far away that you must ask, who will cross the sea to bring it back to us so that we can hear it and obey? No, the message is very close at hand. It's on your lips and in your heart so that you can obey it. So he said, no, the message is very close. What's that reminiscent of in the New Testament? What's that really make you think of? Then he says there's a command, there's a promise, there's something given. It's very close in.
The kingdom is...
You think of Matthew chapter 3 and verse 1. In those days came John preaching out of the wilderness of Judea, saying what? Behold, the kingdom of God is at hand. It's attainable. In other words, he was telling them there's a command of giving. It's within your reach. And when John came preaching in Matthew 3 and 1, and you'll see the same message Jesus preached in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, he said the kingdom is attainable to you. And so if God's going to give us something, he's not going to dangle some proverbial carrot in front of us, then we can't reach that. And so when God gives us command, that seems so difficult and so lofty as be holy. Well, he's not going to tell us to be holy if it's not attainable. He's not going to tell us to be perfect, even as he is perfect, if it's not something attainable. He's not going to tell us to go and preach if it's not something attainable. And we could go on and on about the commands that God has given us. And so every one of those commands, they're not impossible. Why? Because they cause us to rely upon the one that gives us the ability to do those things he's told us to do. So let's continue. He says in verse 15, he said, now listen. Somebody say, now listen. Remember, I'm telling you something that you can attain, that you can experience, that you can choose. He said, now listen, today I am giving you a choice between life and death. I'm giving you a choice between prosperity and disaster, verse 16. For I command you this day to love the Lord your God and to keep his commands, his decrees, his regulations. How do you do that? By walking in his ways. If you do this, you will live and multiply. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you're about to enter and occupy. Verse 17. But, somebody say, but. He said, but if your heart turns away and you refuse to listen, or if you're drawn away to serve and to worship other gods, that's exactly what the church of Colossae was doing. They were serving other gods. They were turning away. Then he said, then I want to warn you now that you can serve, that you'll certainly be destroyed. You will not live long. You will not have good life in the land that you're choosing to occupy on the other side of Jordan. But he says again in verse 19, today I give you the choice between life and death, between blessing and between cursing. And he said, now I call on heaven and earth to witness the choice that you're about to make. So just like in Joshua chapter 24, he said, choose today. And so we see the scriptures, it repeats it so many times. I want you to choose. I'm going to give you the choice. I'm going to give you the ability to choose and to follow after, or to choose and follow my commands. He said, now I call on heaven to witness the choice that you make. Oh, that you would choose life so that your descendants might live. And he said again in verse 20, you can make the choice by loving the Lord your God and obeying him. He prefaced obedience by saying what? Love. Isn't it easier to obey when you're in love?
Yeah, true.
I mean, in any relationship. You know, if you're married and your spouse wants you to do something, man, isn't it so much easier when your spouse asks you to do something that you love versus somebody that you can't stand? You know, because somebody stranger walks up to you and says, I want you to wash my dirty socks. Who are you? But, you know, Thomas comes home, throws those dirty socks at Samara, and she just, let me wash your dirty socks. She says, honey, I don't want to wash them. I just want to hold them right here. Just get the blessing of her.
Amen.
Amen, he said from the front row. But there's something about that. It's loving. You have a child, you know. Children do certain things after they've eaten, you know, and it's not like I can't believe this is because it's just the care that you have. And so he said you can make this choice by first loving. So love covers a multitude of faults. So love causes us to have a different perspective on things. You do this by loving your Lord, then obeying him and committing yourself firmly to him. This is the key to your life. And if you love and obey the Lord, you will live long in the land that the Lord swore to give unto your ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And so obviously, folks, the will of God here was for them to do what? Make the right choice. And so I just summarize and say, what's God's will for you? To make the right choice. And the thing about it is, he gives you those choices to make. And he makes it crystal clear as to those things. He said, listen, this choice brings life. This choice brings death. I want you to make the right choice, obviously. Because he's not coming to the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. So he said, I want you to make the right choice. And the right choice would be that choice that pertains to life. And they could make another choice if they so desired. Another verse in the New Testament for us to consider, 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9. And it says this, a very familiar verse. It says, the Lord is not slack concerning what? His promises. Some men count slackness, but he's long-suffering to usward, not willing, it's not his will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Why repentance? Because repentance is what gives us access to that which is at hand, which is his kingdom, which is his promises. So God is not slack. In other words, he's not doing something that's going to eliminate you or keep you from walking in his promise. He's long-suffering. He's patient with us. He's given us every opportunity to make the right choice so we don't perish, but that we should come to a place of thinking differently. And he said, not willing. That word willing literally means an intended desire or wish. It is an offer with expectation. And so it's just not like an offer expecting you to turn it down. It's an offer with the expectation of you choosing that. And so when Jesus Christ came and he died upon the cross, he gave his life as a ransom, he had the full expectation for men to choose him, even though he knew that they wouldn't, but he expected them to. Why? Because he's not willing. It's not his desire. It's not his expecting him for men to perish, but to come to a place of repentance, right? So that's his desire. He said, this promise is to you and to those who are far off and to as many that would call upon my name. So his promises weren't relegated or just given to just a select few people, but it was the whosoever will just simply believe that it's attainable. And so I hear people say this all the time. They say, God willing. You ever say that? Hey, you know what? Let's go do something. Well, God willing. What do you mean God willing? Dot, dot, dot. People say that too, as though their obedience is somehow contingent upon God forcing or manipulating them against their own will. People say that all the time. What do you mean, God willing? Well, you know what? Hey, man, I'm gonna go help you tomorrow, God willing. As though God's will is just based upon your obedience. No, God says, listen, here's the expectation. Here's my preferred choice for you, and that's easy. And so God's will isn't, you know what? Hey, man, I'll see you tomorrow at lunch. Yeah, God willing. You know, why have we reduced the will of God to almost like a parlor trick or a party game, or let's make a deal, or let's choose some type of A, B, or C. That's not what the will of God is. And so God's will, plan, desire is never for anyone to perish, yet his desire or will is only expressed through man's willingness to align with that will, to responding to his word through the influence of grace. And so when I'm walking under the influence of God's grace, I know what God's will is. My choices are going to be in alignment with the heart and the desire of God. So God states his will emphatically to all those that he prefers in which to produce a preferred outcome. So I prefer you to make a choice that's going to produce the preferential outcome in your life. And so then he leaves it up to us or the person to choose whether or not we're going to make the will of God our choice. That's what he leaves to us. I'm going to tell you my will, and I'm going to leave it to you whether you want my choice or you want your choice. That's what he got. I'm going to give you my preference for you. And so Paul's platform was not one established upon Paul's perfection, write this down, but upon God's preference. Okay, what was his platform? The office of an apostle. And so his platform was not established, or his apostolic calling was not put upon him because of his perfection. God didn't say, hey, here's a guy that was on the up and up. Here's a guy that embraced my message off the bat. Here's a guy that when other people were rejecting the message of the Messiah, man, he got in lockstep. He was just the opposite, wasn't it? Concerning zeal, what did he do? He persecuted the church. Yeah, he had all the law stuff down, which the Bible says that, listen, if that's how you think your righteousness is attained, you've made the work of my redemptive purpose and plan of none effect. And so he did all the wrong things. But he had a platform that wasn't built upon what Paul the Apostle did or didn't do. His platform was built upon God's preference. God preferred Paul to walk in that calling. And so many times, here's what we think to ourselves. Well, God, if I can perform enough, you hear me? If I can just do enough good things, or if I can just impress the right people, then you'll choose me to do something. Folks, please don't get caught up in that works mentality like that. Please don't get caught up in that. Or if I can just get the attention of this preacher or this leader or this person, then suddenly I'll do that. Folks, listen, we're not in the man-pleasing business. We're not in the men establishing something in you that God has not established in you business. And so your call, your office, your platform, whatever it happens to be, is not going to be built upon your perfection, but it's going to be built upon God's preference. And so that's essential to understand as it pertains to our relationship, really even to God-appointed leadership in our life. Pastor Jack's been talking about leadership and how we do that. So we got to understand it. I got to understand when God is saying, that's my preference. Now, sometimes I don't understand why God prefers certain things. I don't understand. God knew the inside when he went to the Mount of Transfiguration that he only took Peter, James, and John with him. He knew that. I'm sure the others were saying, listen, they're getting preferential treatment. Yes, they are. Next question. Well, God preferred that. God knew exactly what he was doing. He knew the preferential situation that was going to produce the greatest benefit for the kingdom. He knew who I had to reveal myself to. He knew what I had to do. He just chose 12 people. He said, I chose 12. One of you is the devil, right? So those 12 could have said, well, why didn't he choose 24? It wasn't fair. He could have chose 100 or 200. He only chose 12. Well, that's God's preference. God has got a perfect will that's evidently worked. Because here we are standing 2,000 years later, and all this was is some people before the advent of the internet or any type of mass communication, and we're the beneficiaries of God's preferred will. I'm saved because God preferred some people in an ancient culture rather than people today. Something's working. We've got the gospel preached into all the world. The most reproduced and published book ever is what we call the Word of God. God chose it that way. And evidently something worked out to God's plan. And so I made the point last week that if we were living in Paul's day, that most of us would probably not have liked Paul the Apostle very much. We wouldn't have. So we think sometimes because we can read the printed words on the page and we can kind of have this idea of what kind of guy this was or whatever else. But if you really kind of look at his life and kind of look at kind of where he was most of the time and what he did, man, this wouldn't be the guy that we would hang out with very often. And so he probably didn't have the type of personality that most people would have liked. You know, I don't read a whole lot. I'm studying Todd through his writings and epistles. Listen, he probably was not the life of the party. You know why? Because he didn't ever get invited to the party. He was usually incarcerated somewhere, so he wasn't the guy that was there. He wasn't the guy that was making the stunning Facebook post and had the Instagram account with a million followers. He wasn't the guy. And so most people probably would not have liked him. His sermons probably were not the most interesting sermons to listen to. They weren't. Why do I say that? Huh? Talking about Eutychus. What's that? Acts 29. Here he was. There was a young man, Eutychus, sitting in the third story window. Don't get any ideas over here, Justin. And it said that he was, he says that Paul went on and on and on. I said he went on and on. And so he was sitting in the window sill and fell out and broke his neck and died. And so Paul wasn't the most interesting guy. It didn't say, you know, he's the cutting edge. He's the mega church pastor guy. So he wasn't the most interesting guy to listen to. He was probably, man, I got to keep my eyes. I'm fighting to say, to do it. So he didn't have that type of captivating presence. You know what's interesting? Some of you have heard of David Wilkerson, for instance. I remember back in, this had to be circa 1987. I was in Baton Rouge in Bible College, and the one and only time I actually heard David Wilkerson preach in person. And so I had read The Cross and the Switchblade. I had read certain things that he had and things of this nature. And so my idea was when he walked across that stage and stood behind the pulpit, man, it would be just this bombastic presence. That's what I was thinking. Because mind you, I was in a church that the pastor, the guy that was preaching every week, was that. It was Jimmy Swaggart, the guy that was on TV. And, you know, man, Stormin' Norman pretty much. I mean, this guy was the evangelist, pounding the floor and preaching to tens of thousands and giant coliseums. And so I'm thinking, man, David Wilkerson's going to get up, this prophetic voice. But he's going to get there and he's going to be shaking his fist. Man, he's a little old dude. I mean, this guy looked like Angela. He just stood behind the pulpit, deep-set eyes, skinny as a rail, not intimidating at all, hair kind of tussled back, and he stood there with his hands on the pulpit, and he never moved. I'm like, this dude just isn't the most entertaining or energetic guy I've ever seen. What was this, a bad day? Well, he was God's preferred choice. I had to listen to what he said. You hear me? He wasn't entertaining me into the conversation. He was speaking a word that I needed to listen to, and his word had weight. It wasn't because of his personality type. It wasn't because of his physical attributes or prayer. It wasn't because of any of those things. Man, there was weight to his word because God preferred him for that office and for that place. And so don't think that you've got to be pigeonholed into something or somehow preformed to get God's perfect. So for preference. So Paul the Apostle probably was not the most exciting guy. He might have probably was not even at your beck and call every 5 minutes. So he wasn't the guy that you send the text messages to at 2 o'clock in the morning and say, why aren't you answering? Why aren't you answering? Well, number one, he didn't have a phone. Okay. And so it took a long time for a letter to arrive anywhere. So it wasn't like he was at your beck and call. Probably wasn't able to solve all your financial crises. I can't believe that church, that pastor didn't help me. You know, they knew I was in a bad spot. Paul's like, dude, how am I going to help you? I'm locked up. So he wasn't doing that. Probably would expect most of the people to take on lots of personal responsibility. And listen, I'm going to tell you the truth. But beyond that, I can't baby you. I can't walk you through it. Now, you've got to take some personal responsibility. I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm going to tell you God's preferred will. Then it's going to be up to you to do it. He wasn't trying to make high maintenance, low impact converts. He wasn't the micromanager. It probably wasn't ever available to speak at your conferences or your conventions. Just wasn't available to do those type of things. You know, typically it was probably around right after getting snake bit around a campfire after they got shipwrecked, talking to a few guys or whatever else. So it wasn't like he was the guy that was on the pages of Charisma magazine or blasted across a TBN or whatever. So none of those things that we look for probably did he have. But he was God's preferred vehicle. And so we probably thought, you know, what gives this guy, here's what we'd have thought, what gives this guy the right to tell me anything? Who do you think he is? He don't give me no money. He's not that interesting. Personality's got a lot to be desired. You know, he's never available, never answers my calls, never answers his door. You know, he's not helping me through every bit of life's crisis. So what gives this guy the right to tell me anything? See, we think about that, but folks, listen, probably most of us at one time or another with regard to a God-appointed leader, we've said the exact same thing. We have this expectation that's not built upon God's preference, but it's built upon our desire. Not the desire of heaven, but the desire of our flesh. You should have done more. You should have been there. You should have done this. Folks, you know what I'm glad of? I'm glad I got that figured out way early in my walk. Because when we got married and we were serving the Lord, we never had nobody knocking on our door asking if we was reading the Bible. We never had that. We didn't have anybody babysitting us. And when our pastor moved off and left, well, I tell you what, we didn't have anybody tell us you need to get plugged into church and you need to go minister. We never had anybody telling us those things. We never told anybody that you need to stay on the straight and narrow. We never did that. We never had anybody, except the Holy Ghost who was inside of us. And so 38 years later, you know what? Man, we never had to shake our hand in heaven and say, I can't believe that pastor left me. I can't believe that preacher never gave me an opportunity. I can't believe that. Folks, listen, it was funny. When we moved from New Orleans to go plant the church in Daytona, I have credentials with a large Pentecostal denomination. And one of the things they ask you to do is when you go from state to state, you call the next state's bishop or overseer of their office. Hey, listen, I'm just going to let you know I'm transferring my stuff into your state. So my records and my monthly reporting will come under your state. So I remember calling them. They'll probably remember this story. So I called the denomination there in Florida. I said, hey, listen, I'm just moving to Florida, and I'm just letting you know what that I'm here. And, you know, if you need anything from me, here's my information. And the person on the other end of the line said, hey, listen, so what you really probably first need to do is you need to find yourself a good, solid, they named the denomination church, get there, and just get assimilated and amalgamated into that local church, and maybe some opportunities will maybe present themselves to you there. And I'm like, whoa. What do you think I was calling you for? You thought I was calling because I need you to take me up as a statewide evangelist or missionary? You thought I was calling you because I need you to let me go preach in people's churches? I'm like, dude, listen, I'm like, I don't need that. I got enough work to do. I said, so this assimilation and amalgamation, I said, that sounds like something you do with a mayonnaise sandwich. I said, man, I don't need that. I said, I was just going to let you know I was here. And so, no, I'm not asking to preach in your churches. I'm not asking to be in your conferences. I'm not asking for your money. And they didn't even know how to respond to that. Because they were used to somebody saying, listen, I'm here in the state now. I need you to make things happen for me. I had enough going on my own time that I did not need them to ask me. And so we got to take that type of mentality that, listen, it's not the job for somebody else, quote unquote, to make something happen for us. We've got to say to ourselves, listen, man, I've got to just walk in the preferred will of God. And so they were saying, why has this guy got the right? We're the ones doing the heavy lifting. We're the ones that have the responsibility. We don't need him. And you know what? We're actually better off without him. That's what they were thinking. How do I know that? Because they departed from that. You know who else said that? The church at Galatia said that to me. You know who else said that? The church at Corinth. How do I know that? Well, I can see what they did. He had established those works, and somewhere along the line, they're saying, listen, this dude's out of sight. This dude's out of mind. We don't care what God's preference was for this church. He's not meeting and fulfilling our needs, and so we're going to cut him off. Now, folks, listen, that still happens. That happens to me. Amen. And so, listen, we're in good company on those things. And you know what? Chances are, depending on the governmental office and thing that God calls you to, it'll probably happen to you too. You'll lose your usefulness to people because they'll think, listen, you got me as far as you're going, and listen, I really don't need you anymore. Whatever God's preference was, we're moving on from it. And so he said, no, it's not because you did the heavy lifting, not because you have the lion's share of responsibility. It's not because you're the ones that have to support your own work. He says, no, I'm an apostle by the will of God. That's it. There wasn't a contest for it. There wasn't a pulpit committee that got together and I auditioned for them and I had the most fiery message or I babied everyone or catered it to folks and brought apples to the teacher or whatever. He says, listen, the reason I'm an apostle, the reason I have this platform is for one reason. God gave me that platform. That I was God's preference in this situation. It was God's preference. So that's an important issue. Psalm chapter 75, you'll be familiar with this when I quote 75, 6, and 7. It says, promotion doesn't come from the east. It doesn't come from the west. It doesn't come from the south. But it says, God is the judge. He's the one that raises up one, and he puts down another. And so if you don't get raised up the way you want to, don't blame me. Don't blame Pastor Roy or Pastor. Blame God. Well, because he knows our heart. He knows what his preference is. He knows who he wants to use. He'll use whoever he desires to use. And so what we've got to do is we've just got to align our heart with God's will. And so whatever God tells us to do, whenever God tells us to do, even if it's just sit down and shut up, man, we're in line with it. You hear me? Because sometimes it's, man, if God just tells me to sit down and shut up, man, I'm okay with that. I don't have to be in the firing line. Or if God tells you to stand up and speak up, that's God's preference. Remember, though, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 and 12. And he, speaking of Jesus, he gave some to be apostles and some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers. To do what? To perfect the saints for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. And so, folks, listen. Those offices or those gifts or those positions of leadership were given and have been established by the will of God, not by the whims of man. And so when he says, I've given you, those are things that were established upon God's will, not because of our whims or our desires. We said, hey, listen, man, I think it would be real cool to be such and such. And so if I sign up and I go to the seminary and I take the right classes, then I check the right boxes. You know what? Somebody's going to recognize me and call me a pastor. Folks, we taught on God-appointed, self-appointed, and man-appointed leadership. Well, there's only one that God prefers, and that's God-appointed. And so we say we can do those things. You know what? You'll get yourself a job, but you'll just be a hireling. You won't be somebody that operates under the auspices of the will of God. And so those are things that God has given us. And the reason there is a God-mandated authority and an empowerment that's associated with them, that apart from God's appointment, there's no authority. There's no empowerment. There's just a job. There's just a vocation. But I pointed out last week to you that the office of the apostle, obviously the platform that Paul spoke from, was something specifically and strategically and graciously given by God for a unique purpose in that church. Very specific. He said, I'm calling you to do that. It's my will. And I'm giving you something that's strategic. I'm giving you something that's really graciously given. Something that's very strategic. And that office and its subsequent authority, really, ever since that day, has been under an enormous attack. Why? Because most people have abandoned the necessity of that role within the framework of the church. Most people, honestly, most churches, most pastors really don't see the need for that office in application. You know what they'll do to themselves? They'll say, hey, listen, I'm the pastor of this church. I don't need that authority over me. I don't need that authority here. So what I'm going to do is, I got a better idea. I'm just going to appoint myself the apostle in my own hand. Now, they may not do it in title, but they'll do it in action. And so rather than be God's preferred will, it's because something I'm doing it as a result or the consequence of fear or sin or unmet expectations or disappointments or the preacher wasn't available enough or he wasn't or the apostle wasn't interesting enough or he didn't support us enough. Folks, all of those things are still happening today because I've seen them for years and years and years. And so this office is designed to genuinely serve really as a conduit in the channel in which all the other offices function in an optimal manner. Listen, if that office is in operation, like Paul was trying to reestablish order, all the other offices function in an optimal manner. And so this is why the role of the apostle has really been rejected by those that really should honor it and see the vital role that it has. And even though many times it's been falsely misappropriated and people claim the role for themselves and they attach it to something else apart from the direct will of God. So many people have just abandoned that or rejected that office. I'm going to give you some personal examples here in a minute, but turn to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Now it's funny, we preach this stuff. I preach this off the street all the time, especially with verse 2. But I'm going to jump up here and look how this applies to what we're talking about, the platform in which he's writing this letter. Once again, Paul the Apostle writing this letter to the church of Rome. He said, dear brothers and sisters, he said, I plead with you to give your bodies, yourselves to God because of all that he's done for you. He said, let yourself be a living and holy sacrifice. Let it be the kind that he finds acceptable. This is the true way to worship him. He said, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way that you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Us King James guys, we would say, don't be conformed to the image of this world, but be rather transformed by the renewing of your mind, so you can prove what is the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. I gave you the NLT version of that in writing, but you know, we're King James quoting folks. And so, huge point here. Huge point. Don't miss this point. I'm going to give it to you. He said, don't copy. Don't conform. Don't mimic. Don't reproduce what the world sees as the best way or the best one to accomplish the task or assignment that I've given you. Don't mimic it. Don't reproduce it. Don't copy it. Don't think that somehow the world has got a better way of doing things than God has. That's what he was warning them about. How many times have we preached to God? We had somebody come up the other day, some ladies that I witnessed to. And one of them, it was a lady and her daughter, and it looked like maybe a gender bender sister that was with them. Yeah. Anyway, the lady was sitting there telling me that she loved the Lord, and, you know, as she was blowing cigarette smoke in my face and, you know, had her hand grenade hanging on her arm, and she was saying, listen, this is my birthday, and that's the reason I'm here, but I love Jesus and all this stuff. And you know what's funny about it? I can remember one of you guys was standing there with me when I was talking to her, and I said, listen, you seem very, very sincere. You seem very sincere. I said, you're just wrong. And I took her to the Word, and you know what? It was funny. She wanted to stand here, and her gender bender sister or whoever that was with her kept pulling her away. This is your birthday. This is your birthday. But she was convinced that she was somehow okay. She wasn't. She thought that her lifestyle, her actions, and all these things, because somebody else had appropriated that to her. And so, folks, listen, when we find ourselves in those situations to try to accomplish a task or think to ourselves, this is how you get it done, folks, listen, the wheels can come off in a hurry. And so stop thinking that it's your job to transform others' ways of doing, but rather see that God is desiring to change the way that you think. Here's what he was saying. He wants to change the way we think or see things in accordance to his will, which is not always in accordance with our wishes. God's will is not always in accordance with your wishes. That's what he was saying in Romans chapter 12. He said, listen, you got to learn to think differently. And he goes on to say, he said, that is what's pleasing to God, and that should be your goal. Is your goal pleasing God? If your goal is pleasing God, you're always going to ask yourself the question, not what pleases me, or what pleases God, but rather what pleases God. Folks, I tell you what, one of the toughest things for people, and I hear it all the time, folks, are looking for a church. Man, we're going around to churches. We want to pick a church. You know what? I hear people talk about it, heard talk about it for 38 years. And usually when people go to church, they go in looking for something that does what? What do people say? I really, what, felt comfortable. Have you heard that? I've heard people say, they don't say, listen, I went to that church, man, and man, I felt convicted. No. Most people aren't looking for a church where they feel convicted. Most people are looking, I'm talking about in large, they're looking for a church that, man, I really felt comfortable there. You know, this person said, maybe they said, listen, I really felt accepted. I know, you know, I've got this girl on the side that I'm living in sin with, and I'm drinking all the time, but man, I walked in there and I just felt like they accepted me just the way I was. I didn't feel bad. You know what? Man, they had a couple songs and all this cool little stuff and about a 15-minute, you know, pep talk. And, man, they didn't ask me for money. And, man, I felt I'm going back to that church. See, folks, a lot of times what people are looking for is things that make us feel comfortable, not convicted. And we're not looking for anything to change us or challenge us. We're looking for things to confirm already what we want. And so what is it? That should be our goal. Then he goes on to say in verse 3 of Romans chapter 12, he said, because the privilege and authority God has given me, that's what he said. He said, I give each of you this warning. Because of the privilege, because of the authority God's given me, I've got a warning for you. Don't think that you are better than you really are. Don't think that you're better than you really are. I hear people say, listen, I can walk into the church and in 5 minutes I can tell you what kind of church it is. No, you can't. You just think of yourself more highly than you can. Now, what gave you that platform to be able to dissect a church in the first 5 minutes? Based upon their decor, or based upon their sound system, based upon the appearance of someone? Really, you think you can figure that church out in 5 minutes? You ain't got that kind of discernment. You ain't got the discernment, amen, to get off the video game. You ain't got enough discernment not to watch and listen to things you do. You got the discernment to walk into the church and suddenly get it figured out. Isn't that amazing? But you ain't got enough discernment to get your life right. But man, God's giving you discernment to get a church of 500 other people's life right. Well, Paul said, listen, your problem is you think of yourself a lot more highly than you should. He said, be honest in your evaluation of yourself, measuring yourselves by the faith that God has given us. So Paul saw his call to be an apostle as both a privilege and as a place of authority that had been administered to him by God himself. Knowing that, he issued to them the warning to, and are you ready for this? Don't think more highly than yourself than you should. It's really what his bottom line was. It, folks, it's interesting that those that typically see themselves as the greatest evaluators of other people's gifts and callings, just like I said, A, personally don't possess the calling or experience themselves. Or B, they have a higher opinion of self, or they're really more impressed with themselves than God is impressed with them. I know people all the time that are experts on how pastors should run the church. I could drop names, and you'd probably recognize some of that. And not one of them has ever pastored a church. But they're experts on how people should pastor church. We meet people all the time that are experts on evangelism that never evangelize. Do it all the time. Listen, I don't like the way you're doing that. Well, what do you do? I don't do anything. I'm just an expert on what you shouldn't do. Well, I don't like the way pastor runs that church. Well, how many churches have you planted and pastored? Well, none. My job isn't pastoring and planting churches. My job is telling pastors how to run their business. Now, they never say that, but that's exactly what their mentality is. Well, I've got to be an expert. I've got a Facebook page and people like my videos. I get arrested or I cause a stink and I got cool people saying you're a martyr. I mean, come on, folks. That doesn't qualify you. That doesn't give you the preference of God. That just gives you the accolades and the attention of men. And so the apostle didn't say be honest and fair in your evaluation of others. He said be honest in your evaluation of yourself. Are you an honest evaluator of yourself? An honest evaluator of yourself. And so he gives us the measuring stick by which we are called to evaluate ourselves. And he said, we're measured by the faith that God has given us. Measure or evaluate yourself by the faith that God has given you. Not by the talent, not by the education, not by your popularity, not by anything else. He said, I want you to measure or evaluate yourself in whatever role God's called you to by the faith that God has given you. And so what is your level of faith? Because whatever level of faith is what he wants you to measure yourself by. And so if I say, look, listen, man, I need God to increase my faith. And so I understand that probably my personal evaluation is not probably going to be where it needs to be. And so what do I got to do? Man, I got to get other eyes of faith. I got to trust that evaluation. I mean, I got to let God build up my faith so I have an honest evaluation of really who I am. Goes in the same verse 4. He said, just as our bodies have many parts, and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We have many parts, one body, and we all belong to each other. Then in verse 6, in his grace, it says, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. He's given us certain gifts to do certain things well. He didn't say do certain things bad. He didn't say do certain things average. He said when God gives you something and it's appropriated by him, you'll be able to do it and you'll be able to do it well. And so God's grace, God's divine influence is the only thing that empowers our gift to function to the level in which God desires it to function. The things that I do well, I do under the influence of God's grace upon my life. And when I submit to the gift and office that he has called me to. And so when it's going good, I got to give God the credit. Do you hear me? When it's going bad, I got to say, listen, I'm functioning under my own power, my own influence. But when I allow God to influence by his grace and empower that gift, then I'm functioning effectively and I'm producing much fruit. And so it goes on. So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out as much as faith as God has given you. If your gift is serving others, serve them well. If you're a teacher, teach well. If your gift is to encourage, be encouraging. If it's giving, give generously. If God has given you leadership ability, take that responsibility seriously. And if you have the gift of showing kindness to others, do it gladly. So prophesying, serving, teaching, encouragement, giving, leadership, kindness. He said, listen, activate your faith, your gift through faith and let it be empowered by grace and stop trying to lay claim to that which God has personally assigned to somebody else. Stop trying to lay claim to it because you don't like the way somebody else is doing their job or their call or their assignment. And as a result, you're leaving yours totally undone and underdeveloped. Folks, listen, I've known people that had the gift of prophecy that wanted more than that. I can tell you, a guy that a particular gift of not specifically word of prophecy, but gift of word of knowledge, that was not happy with that. He wanted a different platform. He thought another platform would give him more notoriety, but he was really gifted in that area. What about those that are called to serve that don't hold that calling in high regard? He said, listen, if you're a servant, serve. Develop that. I mean, I know people that embrace that call to serve. I know some other people that really God has called them to serve and they despise it. Because after a while, they're like, listen, man, God has given me the ability to serve, but people don't appreciate me. Well, you're acting like he appreciates everybody he gave the gift to prophesy. They'll hate you for that. And so if you've been the gift of serving, listen, I need to develop that, and I don't need to serve to please man. I need to do it to please God who's graced me in that area. What about those that have been set apart to teach that won't even take the time to teach?
Come on.
I know people that have a tremendous gift of teaching.
Yes.
You just can't nail them down long enough and get them committed long enough to use it.
Mm.
Or what about those that have the gift of encouragement that would prefer a different position? I gave the testimony last week of one of my associate pastors. Man, this guy, I tell you what, the greatest gift of encouragement I've ever been around. Totally. You know exactly what I'm talking about. Man, he's the guy that you wanted opening your service every single week. Man, he talked to you, you felt like $1 million. Man, if I ever fell down, hey, brother, come over, just talk to me for a minute. Man, he had the gift of encouragement. Well, the problem was he wasn't satisfied with his gift. He thought his gift somehow usurped my gift. Well, because I was a guy that, you know, they liked him better than me. Well, he's more likable than me. He got invited to the parties, man, because he's better at it than me. And so he's thinking, you know what? Man, I don't need to be second fiddle. I don't need to be the guy that's got the bionic gift of encouragement. I need to be the guy calling the shots because, man, I'm not encouraged in my encouraging the gift. He's not in the ministry anymore. I wonder how encouraged he is. He's not encouraging anybody with his disobedience. But man, he was a superman of encouragement. He was the guy you wanted to be around, but he got dissatisfied with what God called him to do. What about the person that's been blessed so that they can give?
Come on.
But they won't let go of the blessing.
Come on.
It's like, man, praise God. Man, God has blessed me. Man, given me. Man, you won't believe it. Man, my job is so much better. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold on to it. God don't bless us not to be a blessing. If God's given you the gift, amen, of blessing in order to give, he wants us to give more, and so he can give us more to give.
Yeah.
What's funny, folks, listen, I got the gift of giving. I just tell you, I do. I didn't have it when I had anything to give. I had the gift of giving when I didn't have anything to give. We had people, literally, we got married. It'll be 36 years this coming November. Within 2 weeks of getting married, we had somebody living in our house. We had a mother, her husband, and a brand new baby lived in our house, and we didn't have two dimes to rub together. And so we did. We'd buy a little pack of hamburger meat and a few little groceries and put up in the cabinet for the meal, and we'd think, okay, hey, we're gonna get home today, and we're going to prepare a meal for our little family and for this little couple that's with us. And we get home, you know, we find out they ate everything while we was gone. Then they were storing food in their own room that they could eat later, you know. We're like, but we gave. And so we were always just givers. And as a result, God just always gave us something else to give away. Well, he can trust you. So listen, he's giving you the gift of serving. Serving. God is going to give you more ability to serve or to encourage. He's going to increase that. What if God has blessed you with leadership, but you're too afraid to lead? You don't want to lead. Folks, listen, I asked two guys at a meeting one time. I said, hey, how many leaders we got here? Pastor Alex, remember this story? And I had these two guys raise their hands, say, yeah, we're leaders. And I said, who are you leading? And instantaneously they pointed at each other. I said, that's not leadership, that's a dog chasing its own tail. He thought he was leading him. That's like Dumb and Dumber, blind leading the blind. They were convinced they were leaders because they'd sit around telling each other what to do all the time. They weren't leading anyone. They weren't reproducing anything. They just constantly were. Well, maybe God had something for them, but they were willing not to make the sacrifices. Or what about if you got the gift of kindness? Folks, there's people who got the gift of kindness that won't cultivate that, and they see it as a weakness. Now, I'm kind, but people run over me. Well, look at Jesus. Jesus obviously was the epitome of the gift of kindness. Man, it's his kindness, his goodness that brings us to the fence. What we didn't just run over him. We crucified him. And so we think that kindness is it makes us weak. No, kindness demonstrates the strength and the character of God in our life. How many of you said to yourself, well, I'm not going to be nice to them anymore because they're not nice to me? So what you're saying is the development of your gift is dependent upon someone else rather than the Holy Spirit that deposited in your life. It's not according to the faith that God gave you. It's according to the response that somebody else had in relationship to your kindness. Folks, see, I want to be a kind person. I want to be mercy motivated. I want those gifts to operate in my life. And when I didn't have them, man, I said, God, listen, I want to tap into a resource and I want to practice that stuff because I need those things. And I didn't say, listen, man, God, I may not have that, but I'm asking you to deposit stuff in me and I'm going to be faithful in developing those things. So we've got to be faithful. So Paul was up against a group of people that really had refused to recognize not only their own callings and responsibility, but as a result of not recognizing them, they didn't want to recognize his either. And so as a result, this office of apostle, his platform, has been either abandoned or abused. Think about this. I stated that what this done is led to really this unbiblical balance of power that really relies kind of upon the wisdom of men rather than the will of God. And so subsequently, what it's led to is all these man-dependent forms and formulas. But listen, here's what I want to take. It's also served to eliminate those things that would correct the error. If I eliminate the office of apostle, I also eliminate that which would correct that, which is the biblical office of prophet and evangelist. And I'm going to tell you why. Okay, if you want to know why you don't see the office of prophet and biblical office of evangelism like it should be, it's because of the absence of the office of the apostle. I'm going to tell you this. Once the church became largely devoid of the influence the office of apostolic gift, because it allowed for the rejection of the prophet and it redefined the office of evangelist to kind of an itinerant traveling teacher or minister. That's what it became. Because there was no one in place to correct that. See, the office of an apostle is to correct false doctrine, false teaching. And so when suddenly the evangelist, instead of teaching and equipping the saints for the work of the ministry, just became the guy in the flashy suit and the backup song tracks and the five canned messages, he's no longer winning the lost or equipping the saints to do the same. Nobody can correct that. Because the existing offices simply embrace what is now. Because those offices were a threat to the other. Let me explain. And so the apostle, its most simple definition, is a sent one. That's what it is, a sent one. And so the reason the office of an apostle works differently is because it's wired differently. It does. It works totally differently. It's wired totally differently. See, apostles are sent out to send in. Do I need to say it again? Apostles are sent out to send in. They're not wired for warehousing, but they are called to a commission. Example, this ministry, this person, my call is to establish churches, ministries, to send others, to kind of govern them on local levels. To do that. That's my job. That's what I do. And I wouldn't say, quote unquote, it's easy, but it's natural for me. It's natural. I don't get bent out of shape. I don't walk in a fence when people I'm wired. I'm just not wired for that. And you know what? I've been burned a million times. And you know what? I'm going to get burned a million more times. People won't like me. People will fall out of the window when I'm preaching or just say, man, he's not that interesting. They'll do that. I'm okay with that. I'm totally fine with that. Because I'm wired to be fine with that. I understand when I accepted the platform that God has given me, I have to accept the consequences that are associated with that platform. And so it's also to empower and mobilize other people for ministry. So we become a conduit for commissioning. And so I mentioned earlier that the platform in which he was given to him by God. And this enabled him to speak to the church frankly and with a degree of authority that did not exist elsewhere. The problem is once that office was abandoned, then suddenly the church removed the prophet, removed the evangelist, and the lion's share of responsibility and mentality fell upon whom? the pastor and the teacher. Now, here's what I mean by that. We were, before I started pastoring, we were in a church, and probably at the time, and Holly and her mom had gone to that church and passed as well. The church was probably 3,500 people at the time. I think it's like 7,000 now. Okay, 7,000 member church, okay, in this town, at one address. 7,000 people. Now, in that town, there were hundreds of other churches strategically placed in strategic neighborhoods. Some were in middle-class neighborhoods. Some were in affluent neighborhoods. Some of those little community churches that were doing a good work were in very poor neighborhoods. And you know what? Many of those churches were struggling to fill particular roles in those churches. Man, you may have this guy that's got a church on the bad side of town that, man, he would give anything to have somebody that could teach the children. He's getting these kids, and man, he has his hands full with the adults. But, man, he's got like 60 kids that are showing up every single week that just need somebody that's called to reach children. A few miles down the road, there's this church, man, that they love God. The preacher preaches like a house on fire, but they don't have a musician one. And so they got some old lady that's strumming a guitar singing "We'll Fly Away" every week, and most of the people are flying away because they can't stand it. But across town, there's this church of 7,000 people. And there's hundreds of musicians there that are dying for a chance they're never going to get on that stage. There's people that have been that moved into that city from other places that love kids. They have a call of God upon their life. And they're in a rotation that every 6 weeks they might be able to minister a canned message, and they never get to really walk and fulfill their giftedness. And you know what? That pastor's just warehousing them. He would never say, "Guys, listen, my job is to be sent in to send you out. And so what we're going to do is we're going to invest in our city. We're not going to say, come and see. But man, you know what? I've been meeting pastors all over our city. We've got thousands of people here, and all you do is come here and sit. I know that you've got a burden. And so what we're going to do, hey, do we got a drummer in here that would love an opportunity every week? Stand up. How about a keyboard player? Okay, right over there. Your keyboard, you don't really know what you're doing? Yeah, I'm called to the music ministry. And you don't participate here? No, there's no outlet for me. How about a couple guitar players? Yeah, over here, there's a guitar player. There's a guitar player over there. Man, got anybody that can sing? Yeah, man, I'm singing. I used to sing in the choir at school, and I really have a call to that. And so we got a couple guitar players. We got a bass player. We got a drummer and a keyboard player. Why don't y'all come up here? We're going to call and commission you. And that friend of mine that's got a church on the wrong side of town that can't get those type of people, that's where you're going to be a part of from now. And so you're going to take your gift. You're going to take your paycheck and your tithe every week, and you're going to be a part of reaching that place. Because really here, you're really just taking up space. I wish we had an outlet for you, but there's only so many spaces in my pulpit. But there's places that want for you. Hey, how about today? Do we got anybody that really your burden desires to work with children? 5 or 6 people popping up. Yeah, and youth. Man, you want, there's an area across town that man, these people are in a strategic area that those youth are never going to come over here. Even though we've got Six Flags over Jesus, they can't even get here. Their parents aren't going to come to church, but man, there's a church smack dab in their neighborhood. And so what we're going to do is we're going to plant you and your families and your gifts in that community to impact them.
Right.
See, for me, that's normal. Why? Because of the platform I function from. For a pastor, it's like, no, we got to warehouse them. We're going to hold on to them because you just never know when there's a rainy day. You just never know because if they leave, their money's leaving with them. If they leave, that the numbers are leaving with them. See, that's what I'm talking about being wired differently. The apostle came into that place and his platform was a kingdom platform. And so we fall into false doctrine. False doctrine is usually centered around the selfishness of man, not the sacrifice of man. Because false doctrine usually caters to our personal need rather than the desire of heaven. And so Paul the Apostle comes in. He's like, listen, I want to establish and tell you what the problem is. And so I mentioned earlier that the platform which he was given to him by who? And this enabled him to speak to the church frankly and with authority. And here's what I left you with. To a degree. He could only speak in authority to a certain degree. Why is that? Why do you think that his authority was greatly limited? Because authority is only seen or experienced in direct proportion to those that are submitted to that authority. You hear me? You'll only benefit from the authority that you're submitted to. Where there's no submission to authority, that authority is just background noise. Because it doesn't have a platform, it doesn't have a voice to bring the necessary corrections into a person's life. And so Paul the Apostle goes into a place that has abandoned and rejected his place of authority. But he has to establish it right off the bat. There's many teachers among you, but there's very few fathers. And he says, listen, I've begotten you in the gospel. I may not be an apostle anywhere else, but right here, I'm an apostle. I have the platform here. But his authority would only go as far as him established. So right out of the gates in Colossians 1:1, he's like, listen, I need to remind you something, because this is big stuff that you got to know. This is big stuff. It's not by the will or the hand of man. This is by the will of God. And if you're going to get it, if you're going to break free from the asceticism, if you're going to break free from the legalism and the Gnosticism, you got to understand that I'm speaking from a place and position of authority. Folks, listen, God has given me words for people that I was reluctant to give them to them. You know why? Because I knew they had no regard for the weight of that word for them. Who does he think he is? I don't think I'm anybody. It's a word for it. There's other people, but because I knew the regard they held, the office that they were going to receive that word, it was going to bring freedom to them. And so when God provides a platform for a word into your life or into my life, man, when we submit to that, submit yourself therefore unto God, then you can resist the devil, then he flees. But if I just use that office and that platform, and I just view it and I say, listen, that's just something that I can either take it or leave it, you're right. You can take it or leave it. I've set before you life, and I've set before you death. I would that you choose life. I've set before you blessing. I've set before you cursing. You're right. The choice is yours, but the benefit is only for those who would receive the benefits of that office. Paul was establishing right off the bat. And so he was an apostle, not because he was the most intelligent. I think he was a sharp guy, obviously. Well, the most qualified. I mean, this was a guy that rejected Jesus. He was a murderer. The most likable. Now he was rejected by his own kinsmen. Not because he liked everybody or everybody liked him. No, he booted people out. He called people out by name. No, he was not the apostle because he's the most popular choice. He was the apostle called of God. The person that God had appointed. God had saw him and seen the platform that he gave him. And he was God's preferred choice. That was what God had established. So folks, listen, as we go forth from this, what you're going to see is in some cases, they're going to receive that word. In other cases, they're not going to receive that word. And see, all those things are applicable to us as well. God, you put authorities in my life. Maybe it's an authority, not even a spiritual authority. Maybe it's an authority at work. Well, if I'm subject to that, God's going to benefit me in that. Now listen, when I worked in banking, my last job that I worked in for the last 3 years of my quote-unquote secular career, man, I went into a banking industry that was rank. I mean, the people were foul-mouthed and everything else. But when I walked out of there, they were all born again. Amen. Right down to the manager. We went the day that Ann Willard got baptized and was working in the church. Man, God totally turned her life around. And so I went in, but you know what I did? And we had an office. I'll give you a prime example. I'm the credit manager underneath Ann Willard, and I take loan papers up, say, hey, listen, and the secretary looked at me and she said, what do you say? And I say, my customer will be here at 3:00. I need the papers. No, what do you say? It's like, what do you mean, what do I say? She said, you say please. I said, honey, listen, we're not here because of please and thank you. We're here because these people pay us a lot of money to do this job. And so when I need this paper done at 3:00. And so I had to tell my boss, Ann, will you do me a favor? She said, what's that? I said, don't ever ask me to do anything in this office again. And she went, what? I said, you tell me what to do. I said, because I'm not here for you to ask. I said, don't give me a choice. You need something to do, I'm under your authority. I'm going to do it. I said, because when you do that, it trickles down to everyone else, and they think that they can do it or not, and it's inefficient in our office. And I said, so if you need me to say, Troy, I need you to do this. I got a customer coming in. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to jump on it. You know what ended up happening? I mean, it translated to everyone else. Hey, we're here to do a job. The thank you is 2 weeks from now when we get that nice paycheck in our bank account. The thank you is all those benefits. That's the thank you. And the please is the opportunity we get to show up for work every single day, and there's people that would love to have our job. See, folks, that's what submission and authority looks like. Man, I've got a role, and I know that we can all benefit from that. You'll have a role that you benefit, whether whether it's a boss, whether it's a parent. Man, I want to submit myself to that authority that they have over me. Maybe I won't like it. Maybe they don't seem to be the best parent, or the most entertaining parent, or the most fun parent. But man, if I'm subject to that, I'm going to be blessed as a result of that. Amen. Father, we just thank you, Lord God, for what you've called us to do, who you've called us to be. And Father, we want to get this, Lord God. Father, in this room, Lord God, there's probably many people that, Lord God, will ultimately, Lord God, be raised up and called to the fivefold ministry, Lord God. There's others, Lord God, that you've already given them, Lord God, called them and given them gifts of encouragement, Lord God, gifts of kindness or servanthood. And Father, I pray that they would utilize those giftings, Lord God, in the way, Lord God, that's going to be pleasing to you and your preferred way for them, Lord God. Father, we know that those things are just are help to us, Lord God. Those are measures that you've brought to your church, Lord God, to strengthen us and encourage us, Lord God, to bring us to that place of perfection, Lord God, and usefulness of your hand. And so we just thank you for these things tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Amen.